I'm Mich Turner, and since starting Little Venice Cake Company in 1999, I have created couture cakes for the likes of Madonna, Pierce Brosnan, Sir Paul McCartney, David Beckham, and Gordon Ramsay. And on my show today, there's a wealth of inspiration for your big day. Coming up, a behind-the-scenes look at the photo shoot for my brand new book. A masterclass in hand piping. And I'm at the uber chic Haymarket Hotel to look at options when it comes to displaying your couture cake. I'm here to meet Britta at the Couture Gallery. She's an amazing designer who I know has a style that's quite sculptural, but also some quite contemporary dresses. So I'm really keen to see what style of design she's going to inspire me with today. Britta, it's lovely to
hello.
See you.
Well, hello. Mm, nice
thank
to see
Thank you for
you.
Showing me some of your amazing collections.
You're very welcome.
Now, I know you have a style that's very theatrical.
Yes.
And you have this amazing blend of working with some very soft pastel shades of colours.
Yes.
What I'm keen to hear from you today is what the current trends are you're seeing for wedding gowns this year.
I think for this year, we're seeing a lot more colour come into to the wedding market. Mm-hmm. I use a lot of blush, a lot of very, very beautiful antique ivory, mm-hmm. and sort of moving away a little bit from the usual white. Mm-hmm. I'm quite known for very sculptural fitted corseted dresses that has hidden corsets so you can
stretch it from within.
Yeah, exactly, so you get the perfect shape. Yeah. And then from that I use very simple shapes because it means that you can do a lot of decoration.
Okay.
And use sort of trimmings like lace and flowers and beautiful fabrics.
Okay.
And use it from there.
My inspiration that I'm looking for is to come up with some, maybe one or two dresses that I can feel really inspired by.
Yeah.
That will lend me into designing some amazing wedding cakes.
Yes.
So shall we take a look?
Absolutely.
Let's go. What I'm instantly drawn by is the lovely warm colour palette that you mentioned, all those
yes.
lovely pastel shades of the
yep.
blush and the pink and the embellishments that you've got on the dresses. Tell me about some.
Well, basically, I love working with colour because I think normally the usual white is very harsh on the skin.
Mm.
So picking up on some of the blush ones here, they're very, very beautiful on the skin.
Yeah.
And outside, they look very blush here, but when you're outside in the sun, if you have a summer wedding, they kind of pick on the sun's rays as well.
I find that when I'm working with icing on the cake, if I'm able to take that colour, so rather than working on a plain white or ivory
yeah.
background palette, if I start with a soft caramel or a taupe or a very pale blush pink, it does really enhance the detail that you can then apply on the cake.
Absolutely.
Great.
And it also means that, say for example, with the blush colour of this one here, you can sort of pick up different variations of that colour and put a bit of green in as well. So it means that you have, like you say with your cake as well, that you have a basic colour and then you pick up on the different tones so you can make it lighter or darker.
What I notice about your dresses is they tend to be fairly simple and plain in terms of their elongated, beautiful structure that's underneath.
Yeah.
And then they are accentuated by the beautiful embellishments of either the frill detail here with the ribbon,
yeah.
or for example here with the lace detail.
In order to use so much embellishment, I find it's very, very important to have the basic structure as classic as possible, because otherwise it becomes more like a costume if it's over-designed.
It lends itself to the classic structure of a wedding cake. You know, if you have a two-tier, three-tier, four-tier, whether it's perfectly round or very square, you know, the shape themselves is very structured in a similar way,
yeah.
and then you add the embellishments from there, so you're always starting with a very clean line.
Yeah.
I can't wait to see some of them in action.
Fantastic, let's go.
More from Britta later, but first, if you want to serve your wedding cake for pudding but have a set number of courses at your venue or with your caterers, ask them if you can change the pudding course for an alternative course, like a cheese course. It can be a nice idea to have it on display during the drinks reception. This way, all the guests can see it. You can have a small speech, cut the cake, and it can be taken off to be cut and plated whilst you go on to have dinner. If you're serving the cake for pudding, it will need to be plated and served with a spoon and fork. Today I'm teaching my masterclass how to hand pipe with fresh royal icing. So this involves making the royal icing, which we do from scratch with raw egg white, which we whip to a soft peak stage. We add our icing sugar, we beat till it becomes mallowy but still very like the consistency of double cream that's been whipped, so it should still be nice and mallowy and very shiny. We add fresh lemon juice. So that's how we make our royal icing, which we have to keep in a sealed container until we're ready to use it, and involves then filling piping bags and understanding how to hold the piping bag and how to achieve pearls that don't have peaks and have perfect stripes, and that it's all about pulling the icing rather than pushing the icing. It's a very different medium to what most people are used to because it's not like writing. You don't hold it like this and write with it. You hold it between your first and second finger, and it's your thumb that applies all the pressure, so it's very much like a syringe. Your fingers are there to hold the piping bag steady, they're not to apply any pressure. If I squeeze with my fingers, can you see what happens? The bag starts to open and there's not a great deal coming out. If the bag is nice and taut and I push with my thumb, you'll see the icing starts to come out. What you do is you hold it in the hand that you write with and you use the finger on your other hand, your Peter pointer, to direct it. So you're piping from with two hands effectively, and it's coming into one point. And when you pipe, icing always likes to be pulled. If you've made contact and then you try and push the bag, the icing's trying to go in the opposite direction, you're going to be going against the force. Okay, so it's always with the force. May the force be with you. So even if you're writing your name, you always have to pull the letters towards you when you're piping. What I'm going to do is put a little bit of icing on the back of the heart here, and I'm going to put that in the centre on the top of the cake. I've got the ribbon join at the back of the cake here so that you can be sure where the back is. So you've already got your back and your centre. And now really what I want you to have a go at doing is just piping some delicate pearls around the side of the cake, okay? But the idea is that you have to come into contact with the cake at right angles. Your piping bag should not be at an angle or coming up, it should come directly to the cake. If you come in at right angles, the icing will come out evenly and form even based pearls. So when the pearl touches your cake, it looks like a pearl and not like a blob, all right? Working with a piping bag is usually quite alien to most people. It's something that does require a lot of experience and practice. So we tend to find that the first time people pick up a piping bag, it does feel quite difficult. So it's really good to get the practice from it. You have to hold it very differently to how you do a pen or a paintbrush, and understand that all the pressure comes from the thumb when you're pushing the icing so that it all comes out of the piping bag nozzle in one direction. I want you to be slightly more concentrated towards the base of the cake where the ribbon is. So we'll create almost like little champagne pearls to go on our champagne heart Valentine's cake. And then slightly less concentrated as you come higher up the cake. Pop it on your turntable because then as you can see, it's the turntable that you move rather than handling the cake as you go all the way around. Don't touch the cake with the nozzle. It should be just a smidgen away from the cake so that as the icing comes out, the icing makes contact with the cake, but not your nozzle. And it's a bit like learning to drive when you have to do the accelerator clutch thing. You have to stop pushing and pull the pearl away at the same time in that sort of motion in order that you don't get little peaks on your pearls, all right? And once you've gone round with the white, you can then repeat exactly the same thing in the red. The problems that can occur with piping are not having enough pressure or having too much pressure. It's all not knowing about how hard to push and how fast to go when you're piping. And that really comes about with practice. And what's important to remember is that because the royal icing, as soon as it comes into contact with air, will start to dry, will start to crust, because that's what it's meant to do. You constantly have to keep cleaning the tip of your nozzle on your piping bag, otherwise it's going to crust over. And that can be a major pitfall for most amateurs. It's my wrists or the flat of my hand here that's just resting gently against the turntable, which is giving me something to lean against. It's a two-handed operation so that you can really keep control on where you want the piping bag to direct those pearls. All right, so that is the first one that you're going to achieve. A hand pipe cake will usually get that beautiful breathtaking reaction when you see it. It's something that you can't imagine how it could ever be done. And that's what I love about the beauty of me personally, hand piping cakes, is that real sense of breathtaking, refined quality. Still to come. Who would have thought that in the heart of London, you could have your wedding reception by a swimming pool?
It's hard work, but it's really, really satisfying seeing them alive on the page.
I love it. The colour is absolutely beautiful on Caroline. And now, if you've ever wondered how to display your cake to the best effect at your dream venue, let me show you how.
Haymarket Hotel is this lovely bijou hotel. It's one of a collection of the Ferndale Group. And what I particularly like is that the hotels are all very stylized. You're buying into the aspiration of the hotel. They're all dressed, so you don't need to add a lot of your own details. So your guests feel very at home. There's lots for them to look at and to enjoy in the properties.
Cutting the cake is the first official role of the new bride, and as such, it has huge importance. I'm here at the Haymarket Hotel today to give you lots of advice on how to make that cutting of the cake fantastic. As Keely Shay Smith said when she married Pierce Brosnan, if I have a great man, great dress, great cake, nothing else matters. And how right she was. In a hotel like this, the style of the wedding does tend to be less formal. It's much more about a celebration of a party. It's a real expression of personality. So the cake very much has to fit in and stand up to such a strong decor, which is great because it gives a designer like me the challenge to really come up with some amazing designs. So we're here in the shooting gallery, which for me is one of the most stunning rooms in this building. What I love about it is it has a real sense of occasion. Although this is a bijou hotel, the bride is made to feel incredibly special as she enters into the room. It's a shooting gallery, so it lends itself to having one long, elongated table for a very sumptuous banquet. And the cake in here can look amazing. The location of the cake is quite an important factor because it has to be seen by the guests on display, has to have good access for the bride and groom to be able to cut it. And as a designer or as working with the banqueting manager, it's a good idea to learn from them the most suitable position for the cake. So with such a richly opulent room, what's great is to consider a cake that will reflect that design. With the lovely long elongated table where all of the guests can share, it's really nice to have the cake set on a table on the side, but still dressed in a similar style. What I love about this design in here is it's very, very bold. You're buying into the lifestyle of this hotel. It's rich, it's opulent, it's incredibly indulgent. And this particular style with the hand-piped flocking and the delicate flowers in a rich, bold colour, I think really lends itself to this room. And one of the lovely secrets about this hotel is its own stunning townhouse right next door. The bride and groom, at the end of the day when they've said goodbye to their guests, can disappear gently upstairs with a slice of cake. There are five key important factors when choosing your wedding cake. The first has to be design. It should be a strong reflection of your personality and take into account all the different areas of your wedding. So your dress, your venue, the flowers, the time of year, really, really important. The second has to be flavour, because you don't want to choose a cake that fights with what you've just served for pudding. So are you serving the cake in addition to pudding, or will it be served for pudding? So that's a really key thing to think about, what your personal favourites are and those that your guests might like. The third key important factor would have to be size. You need to have a cake that's going to reflect the number of guests you have at your wedding. So you don't want anything too small. And when you've got a venue that's got very high ceilings, you need to make sure that that cake is really seen visually and has strong impact for your guests. The fourth key factor is location, where exactly you're going to set up your wedding cake. If you're having a reception, that you're going to have the cake on display beforehand during the drinks so that it can be cut and served for pudding is something to consider. And where exactly in the room, whether it's in the middle of a dance floor or on the side dressed by candles. And the final thing to consider is exactly when you're going to serve the cake and how you're going to serve the cake. Is it going to be plated and served a portion to every single guest, or are you going to have it on beautiful silver platters while you start the dancing? So who would have thought that in the heart of London you could have your wedding reception by a swimming pool? What I love about this room is the sultry feel, the very sort of candlelit style, the very informal occasion, and what a wonderful place to set up your wedding cake. With such a nightclub feel into this room, the atmospheric lighting and the candles, what I love is having a cake that's beautifully detailed. I've brought our pearlesque, which is iridescent, shiny pearls, all brushed with topaz luster, so they bounce back in the light. And on the back wall here, what I've done is set little cakes, again with gold glitter, so that if the guests are feeling peckish throughout the evening, they can help themselves. This particular hotel has lots of different rooms, which means that the style of cake can be very different and reflect different kind of parties. You've got the very opulent shooting gallery, so a very quite formal, quite rich, opulent design cake looks amazing in there. And then we have the pool area, which is much more about sort of nightclub, party, fun, lots of sort of dancing going on. So it gives the opportunity there to have a cake that's much more eat and go. So some lovely helter-skelters filled with chocolate-dipped strawberries that the guests can help themselves to, or beautiful little canapé cake that are just, you know, eat me, bite me, that kind of quite sexy. Ask your toastmaster to make the announcement when you want to cut the cake. This way he can invite all the guests to come and take a photograph. For the perfect cake cutting photograph, the bride and groom should stand together. The bride's right hand goes on the knife first, the groom assists her, and then the bride's left hand goes on the top, thus showing off her wedding ring and a perfect smile. Your guests, as well as the professional photographer, will want to capture the moment you cut the cake. Make sure there's enough space for them and it's a good visual impact. Today you join me at the studio where we start on the mammoth task of the photography for my new book. We've got the photographer indoors, the stylist indoors, the editor indoors, so it's all go. My job is to make sure we've got the right cakes to shoot. Let's go and see.
Them like that, so very simple.
It's a project that we're undertaking within the next 2 to 3 months to have 180, 190 pages of cakes, techniques, templates, step-by-steps, baking, decorating, photograph. I'm overseeing a number of people in the studio today. We have our photographer Malu, who's with her assistant, who are actually photographing everything, which for the first time is being shot digitally, which means we see the results much faster and gives a lot more scope for touching up in repro. And I have Ashley, who's our style editor, who's making sure that the pages flow cohesively, that he's got everything he needs to include all the step-by-steps on the actual pages. As you can see, it's very cramped in here because there's so much equipment, more than our normal working studio. We've got the equipment for the camera itself, the PC all linked up with lighting and various components, as well as all my equipment for cakes. And what we're trying to do is obviously make sure we get all the shots done, completed, before the light fades. With this cake, I'm trying to achieve a very delicate balance of the appreciation of the detail on the cake, just set off with the essence of a very fresh, innocent white rose. Almost as though it's been tossed onto the stage at the end of a beautiful performance and it's just all very innocent and very debutante. On the shoot list for today are a number of techniques that are going to be featured throughout the book. Those include some of the cakes that are going to be baked. So we do a step-by-step of the whole recipe, the baking method, whether it's creaming or mixing it all together in the bowl with the ingredients, baking the cake, sampling the cake, and then elements of decorating the different projects that are going to be included within the book. So we need to make sure that with a masterclass, every technique is photographed and covered.
Okay.
So this is day one of around 15 shoot days that we'll be doing in total for the book. So we've got a long way to go. It's hard work, but it's really, really satisfying seeing them alive on the page. Wonderful photography will absolutely sell a cake book. The reader has to literally be absorbed into the pages to be able to see very clearly what's going on, to give them the identity that, yes, I can do that, it's achievable. Be very clear instructions so that you understand how to have a go yourself, but also be very aspirational and desirable so that you want to be able to buy the book to go and decorate those cakes yourself. It's great that I have such a strong passion for cakes. I've done a book every 2 years for the last 6 years, and this is my fourth. And what I find is I'm never at a loss for coming up with fantastic new designs, inspirational designs. And what's wonderful is we're seeing students arriving from literally all over Europe who follow and believe and understand in the principles of what I'm about, which is all about the detail, the beautiful, iconic structure and design of cake, the balance of color, texture, but keeping them really, really clean. To create more heightened drama with your wedding cake, you might like to consider dummy tears. These are tears that are made from polystyrene but covered in icing or chocolate and decorated in exactly the same way. If you're having a large social gathering, it can be a good idea to have the base tier as real cake with the additional tiers as dummy tears. This way, all the cutting cake can be in the kitchen for the chef or caterer to have ready cut, plated, in order to serve at the time. I'm back at the Couture Gallery to find some ideas for my next cake collection. I love this dress. I know it's not one of your structured ones, Britta, but the beautiful detail here with the spaghetti straps and this lovely satin sash of ribbon and lace detail just under the Empire bust line, I was really drawn to.
Yeah.
I think it's a very pretty dress that would look lovely for kind of a beach wedding and that sort of feel to it.
Yep.
And I think I could really highlight the detail from here to make a very delicate, pretty cake.
Well, basically, because I have a lot of clients that are getting married abroad with beach weddings, my usual style with corseted big gowns are not really appropriate for that kind of venue. And I think with this one here, it's very pretty, it's very floating, it's very comfortable to wear as well. And again, as you say, you know, with the lace, it just adds a bit more interest to it. With the lace as well, there's lots of tiny little beads and pearls.
And the sparkle detail that we've got on this ribbon sash that's going around the dress would translate really nicely to a ribbon that I can create in icing. amazing with hand-embellished piped pearls and crystals and detail and lustre, that as it was presented in the room, when guests walk around it or the light shines on it, the detail really sparkles back at you.
And here it is, the Cattleya lace.
So, Britta, this is one of your more sculptured designs and creations. I love it. The colour is absolutely beautiful on Caroline. Tell me what you think.
Well, this one here, again, it's a very simple shape, which allows me to use a lot more embellishment on there. And what I've done, I've created, instead of just using the normal silk flowers, the small flowers, I've taken the same material as the silk duchess and then created the leaves here. On top of that, there's hand-dyed lace to sort of add a bit more sparkle in there. And then we've used, again, the silk flowers on here, where there's a bit of green as well, again, to do a focal point that you can sort of focus on.
So much the same way as if I was going to create this as a wedding cake. I've got all the internal structure hidden inside as you have on your dress, I would have on the cake, so it would be doweled from inside. So you create this amazing silhouette of the shape of the cake, which is very elegant and very streamlined, that you can then add all the additional detail to, which is what I love about the oversized corsage here, but on this very nipped and tucked shape with the beautiful colours. Tell me, if you were going to carry flowers, what flowers would you suggest for a bouquet?
I would say I would definitely pick up in the same colour as the dress is in the blush here. Sometimes we also do that where you can take this on and or off, which means that for when you walk into the church, you can have a big flower bouquet, and then afterwards, when you have got the flowers with you, we can add on this. And it's a good way of, because sometimes all of this is a little bit too much if you then have a massive bouquet of flowers as well. So again, it's about keeping it simple, which means that you can add on the details as well.
So there's that versatility of having these beautiful lines, but being able to make those extra bespoke details to really personalise it for each client.
Absolutely.
That's what I love.
Yeah.
Britta, I've been really inspired by coming to see your collection today. Thank you for showcasing some amazing dresses for me. I can't wait to actually try creating some of these now into some amazing cakes.
Thank you very much for coming. It was a pleasure to have you, and I'll look forward to seeing your new collection.
And here it is, the bows and brooches.